Hey everybody, Rob here. It's time for a couple of new malicious compliance stories. First one, maliciously compliant for a math teacher who failed me the year before, aka the last time he asked me to show more work. Let's jump right in. I was your typical obnoxious teen my freshman year of high school. I was smart, but had an unstable home life that contributed to my poor decision making. Despite my lack of learning and hard work, I had always barely passed my classes. My first year in high school, I had math for my first period. I enjoyed math, but frustrated my teacher by rarely doing my work and even less frequently showing my work. As the year progressed, I fell behind like I did in every class. The second half of the year started and I fell further behind in class and more annoyed with my math teacher. I would typically submit about 10% of each assignment and expect about 10% credit, but because I did not show enough work, he would dock me down to 5%. Despite always being polite, I may have been a sucky student, but I couldn't stand disruptive or impolite students. My feelings toward him were obvious, and when I tried to talk to him about my assignments, it was clear he was also annoyed with me. About 3 months before the end of the year, my sister developed senioritis, which affected me because she was my ride to school. For those who don't know, senioritis is when senior students know they are done with high school, either they know they are going to pass their classes or they've been accepted to college, etc. So they stop caring. Instead of being good students, they decide to do the bare minimum because at this point, nothing in high school really matters. She did not want to go to her first period class, so she started ditching, resulting in me ditching. Initially, I opposed it, but as my frustration with my math teacher increased, so did my absences. Toward the end of the year, I thought I had time to catch up when my teacher ended up reaching his limit. He was frustrated with me and my absences and lack of work that when I was so behind, I had no hope of passing. He got me removed from class for the remainder of the year. I ended up in study hall, detention, for the last 3 weeks. I had to repeat the course the following year, instead of over summer school, because it was an honors class. This resulted in me having a weird schedule because classes were only offered during certain periods for certain grades, and I was a sophomore with freshman classes. I might have also failed honors science. Despite knowing those restrictions, both me and my math teacher were surprised to find that I was placed in his class for the second year in a row. Both of us tried to have me transferred out of his class, but for me to graduate on time, there were no other options. The humiliation of my previous year was enough to make me incredibly motivated. I was determined to do well enough that even if he hated me, he could not have me removed again. I made sure to do every problem for every assignment and turn them in on time. Despite all my effort, my grades were mediocre. My teacher only gave me 1 point for the correct answer, but typically 5 to 7 points for work, and he marked me down all the time. I talked to him, argued that I showed enough work for him to follow, but no matter what I tried, all he would do was to tell me to show more work. A large part of the reason I hated showing work was because I had terrible handwriting. I previously went to a school that required all of our writing to be done in cursive, so I spent years only writing in cursive. I actually enjoyed writing in cursive, and my cursive is beautiful. When we moved for my dad's job, my new school district gave cursive assignments automatic zeros because they were too hard to read. So after years of writing in cursive, assuming I'd never need to print again, I now had to print everything, and my handwriting never recovered. As a result, to submit legible assignments, I tried to write as little as possible. My handwriting is still ugly. After my grade on the first test did not match what I felt I earned, my frustration grew into outright hostility. It seemed that no amount of hard work would get me a good grade. I finally decided that if I was going to be miserable, I would make my teacher miserable too. After trying to spare him the atrocity that was my handwriting, I finally decided to comply. If he wanted to see more of my work, I would show him all the work. No more would I remove confusing and ugly work, no longer would I erase incorrect attempts scribbled across the page because my handwriting was so bad I couldn't write straight, no longer would I rewrite only the relevant work in easy to follow columns. I would write so much work, it would be obscene. I started writing out every single possible step, one by one with labels. If I messed up, I would leave it and rewrite it somewhere else. On every worksheet, I would run out of the allotted room and cram my remaining work into the margins because he did not believe in scrap paper. My assignments went from a few formulas and legible bits of work to cluttered nightmares. Every bit of white space was filled, often spilling onto the back of the paper, because there was not any room left. Homework assignments went from being 2 to 3 pages to 10 to 15 pages, sometimes more. All my assignments were just pages and pages of nearly illegible, ugly, chaotic work. I figured it would take a month of this before he broke and asked me to write less, because reading and grading it was such a chore. About 3 weeks in, I got my first assignment back. It was the higher than any grade I had received in his class. I was a little shocked, but figured he did not have time to be annoyed yet. During the following week, all the assignments I received were scored similarly. Then he finished grading the second test and asked me to come to talk to me about my grade. I was preparing my speech about malicious compliance as I sat down in the chair by his desk, but decided to wait for him to speak first. He handed me my test. It was covered in chaotic work, equations, and letters all over. At the top was 100%. I was stunned into silence. I had never gotten a perfect score on a real test before. My teacher began to talk to me about how impressed he had been with my work lately. He pointed out how, even though my work was chaotic, it showed my thought process. He also pointed out some of the times where I caught my own mistakes mid-problem and corrected myself, and how on previous assignments, I had been doing the same thing. He talked about how before I wrote so little that I typically never recovered once I made a mistake. He told me this was why he did not allow scrap paper. He wanted us to be able to see our mistakes and work as we progressed through our problems. I sat in the chair in shock. I had sat in that chair many times previous, typically to try and debate with him over my scores. I also sat in that chair when he told me half a year prior that I had no hope for passing his class. I sat in the chair of someone I had despised for over a year as he complimented me and told me that he always knew I was capable, and he struggled to watch me fail. He talked about how happy he was to see my progress and basically that he knew I would do well once I stopped making stupid mistakes. I wrote down all the steps to annoy my teacher and prove him wrong and learned instead that I was being a bad student. I learned it is easy to make a simple mistake that can lead to the wrong answer, but when you see your work, it helps you think clearly and catch simple mistakes. By the end of the year, I had one of the highest grades in the class. Home life was still crap. And when we did group work, mainly people wanted to work with me. The math teacher and I became friends. I learned he lived in my neighborhood and would visit him sometimes when I came back to town years later. And he ended up as my favorite teacher of all time. I'm in my last semester of college, took 10 years because life is crazy, and after this semester, I will graduate as an engineer. I have used this lesson every day for every assignment and would never have made it if I had not tried to punish my teacher with malicious compliance. In the end, the teacher got exactly what they were looking for, and the tables were turned on OP. I'm glad OP learned a valuable lesson in this situation. On to our next story. You can't leave until everything is done. Let's jump right in. About 2 years into my previous career, I had gotten tired of working customer service cashiering, partly because you're constantly being watched and other departments hate on you because you don't know how tough my department is. You have it so easy up here. Physically, yes. Mentally and emotionally, and working all random shifts, dealing with Karens, knowing item codes, knowing and enforcing company policy, etc. Big no. So there's an opening in the produce department and I jump on it. Being based on seniority, I easily get the job. At first, things are pretty straightforward. I get trained to be the opener of the department. Other than having to be at work at 4 a.m, stack bins of watermelons outside in 100 plus Fahrenheit degree heat, and constantly having to lift 50-pound boxes of various awkwardly shaped vegetable boxes, the concepts aren't difficult. Keep the product full and appealing and don't forget to rotate. Then things begin to change. Corporate is tightening the labor budget because sales aren't where they want them. Labor is getting tighter and tighter each week. Naturally, as labor declines, we can't get stock out fast enough or we run out of time to order sufficiently and sales dip. Round and round it goes. After a while, we go from having a manager, full opener, a mid-shift between 4 and 8 hours depending on time of the month, sometimes a second half-shift, usually a rookie or someone from a different department to help out, and a full closer, 28 to 36 labor hours per day, to having a manager and two full closers, 24 labor hours per day, every day, no matter how busy or slow. On top of that, the manager doesn't touch much of the product because they come in early in the morning and when we leave for the night, everything has to be full. Now, this makes very little sense to me because that means that all the fresh produce sits out all night. Some is refrigerated and watered. So we have things to pull like strawberries that are extremely perishable just for her, the manager, to put them back out in the morning. This is a big warehouse type store that's infamous for its great produce quality. Not Costco or Sam's Club big, but same idea. As time goes on, we fall more and more behind. We are struggling to keep up. Now she is irate because things are not as full as they used to be. You can't leave until everything is finished, she told us. Every night, all the displays must be full. The load has to be broken down. We get 6 to 12 pallets of fresh product daily. The back room has to be swept, all the product in the back room condensed, and any extra cleaning or other duties she's assigned that day. Oh, and she loads up all the six-wheelers we use to bring out product with stuff we don't need, because she never leaves the back room before we get there. So we start out behind. Months of this, I'm racking up so much overtime, it's not funny. I'm talking average of 1 to 2 hours overtime per day, 5 days a week. Same for my partner. We almost always work side by side, shift-wise, not literally. But he makes more, and they don't like how expensive he is. The only bright side for me is my partner has seniority by about 15 years, so she blames him for everything. However, she won't tell me directly if I'm doing anything wrong. She'll leave a nasty note for me to find later before she leaves for the day, but that's it. Any sane person would realize this is not possible to do by ourselves. Doesn't matter. The day after we both put in 11-hour shifts, she scolds us on how could the two of us put in 22 hours combined and still not get everything done. We explain that everything we had to do, but it falls on deaf ears, and I'm starting to become checked out mentally. So she tells us, "You have to leave on time." So every night, we're faced with a choice. Do we stay and actually finish, or do we leave on time? Doesn't matter, we can't win. If we leave on time, we didn't get everything done. A couple times a supervisor, her boss, came in and saw things not full, and she got in trouble. But if we stay, that's overtime, and we all know how triggering that is to management. Eventually, I'm expecting my first kid, so I get a second job that complements this one, in industry and allows me to service 24-hour locations, meaning I can do it immediately after my shift ends or after a power nap in the car. I'm pretty exhausted and losing patience after a few more months of this. Backroom produce coolers are awesome places to vent and cool off, by the way. But as I said in my last post, I love a challenge. Careful what you wish for. The result. Eventually, we get a new store manager. While this didn't improve corporate policy, this guy turns out to be the best manager the company had ever seen. Literally won manager of the year and got promoted to district supervisor. He fights corporate on their labor policy and proves that the store is more profitable when he spends more labor to make it more appealing and offer superior customer service. The produce manager got forced to transfer stores because my partner had complained to the union about her unreasonable demands and targeting him with harassment, since she always blamed him. He was also Mexican, legal in case you were wondering, and over 40, so two legally protected classes. Years later, I was visiting her new store on a training assignment, and she had also been demoted to customer service. Oh, the irony. Where I believe she still is today. Once my kid is born, the new store manager lets me take all my paid time off, and we all lived happily ever after. Almost. I did get promoted in the customer service department a few months later, but that only led to more stories for another day. I've said this in previous videos and I'll say it again here, but 9 times out of 10, people don't quit a job, they quit a manager. Also, how can a manager manage something that they don't actually do themselves? That's one of my biggest gripes when it comes to management. The ones that aren't hands-on, that don't know the job inside out that they're trying to manage. It's wonderful being self-employed. I want to thank both OPs for posting their stories to the Malicious Compliance subreddit. You can visit them at the links in the description below. Please go there and give them an upvote. Once again, this is Rob from Karma Comment Chameleon saying thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please hit that subscribe button, drop a like, and share it with your friends, and we'll see you in the next one.